I was always with music. And so I cannot imagine myself to be without music. Without any music, without even bad music. I even not think, but I am sure that when we read about the creation of the world, that it was created just a big drum and cymbals and music.
The Rite of Spring is the first domino to fall in the 20th century of music. And it was a domino that created a tremendous reverberation throughout the 20th century. My concept of behind the score is the idea of immersing the orchestra into a comprehensive view of the piece, not from the point of view of their music in front of them, but all of the events and all of the historical events that were happening at the time of the composition. What I experienced last year with the Beethoven Fifth project we did that started this whole program is I saw how an orchestra that was given more tools to get into what they were about to play, played better. I think to be able to enlighten students in this way as they're about to learn a piece of music is the most exciting way to learn a piece of music, in my opinion.
So there is a music program in Taiwan when I was 10. So I auditioned for it, and I was the last one who got in. So all the kids, they have the first right to choose the instrument they want to play. For me, I only have the choice, which is bassoon. So I started to learn bassoon when I was 10, and it was much taller than me. And I just keep playing and playing and try to get better. So I started to practice on this excerpt when I was freshman, because it's a really important excerpt for bassoonists. We have to play that in every audition.
Gretchen Horlocker is a person who's devoted a great deal of her time on the, I call it the guts of Stravinsky, the way in which rhythm moves, and since rhythm is a huge force, she will be delving into that in consort with Michael. So the two of them will pick a segment of the ballet and focus their attention on choreography, on rhythm. That will be an exciting introduction for the orchestra.
Well, I am going to go into a little bit more detail and set the scene for what had gone before the Rite of Spring and Nijinsky's place in choreography and in ballet. The music was written as a ballet, and so I think it's really interesting for the musicians to get the context of dance, especially at the Jacobs School of Music, and especially as we do have a ballet department here. The subject matter was very striking for those days, very controversial for those days. The music, you know, they were using Chopin for Les Sylphides, and then suddenly to use Stravinsky, and the very difficult rhythms and the difficult tonality of it, I think, yeah, created a furor, especially in Paris, which was very conservative at the time. Things about Nijinsky's choreography is that it tends to be very much a movement on each beat for the music, which is very difficult to achieve. And also, you know, Nijinsky counted throughout the performance, so that the dancers would hear the counts, because it was so difficult. And one of the things he had to do when the furor started was to scream. He had to count really loudly. Well, that's what the stories say, because, you know, there was so much commotion in the audience, you know, boos and screams and...
The
The presentation that we're doing is an opportunity for us to talk about the piece as an icon, and to my particular interest was bringing in some ideas about how it was a dance piece originally. It has a lot of unusual accentuation that can be difficult to play. And in many, many cases, the students are playing contrasting lines one on top of each other, and it requires a precision of listening to each other as well as themselves.
I think it's really interesting to see different choreographers' take, if you like, on the Rite of Spring. How some people see it more romantically, and some people, there's one version which I'm going to show, which is quite violent.
I think this piece remains important in our kind of canon of modern pieces, because it brought to many, many listeners, and still does bring to many players and dancers, the notion that it's possible to be beautiful at the same time that things are dissonant or that they're complicated.
One, two, three, one. Let's try one more time. We don't move it together. Two, three, one. Okay, that's better. Let's try this tempo together. Flutes, violins, and oboes.
This is a work that's become a great training piece for learning how to deal with very complex rhythms, how to play these remarkable solo parts in the winds. And it's a real stepping stone for a young performer. So it's exciting. It's as exciting for me every time I play it. And I can only imagine that if I'd never heard it before in 1913, this would have been hair-raising in every way. Our last speaker will be the formal scholar on Russian music and Stravinsky.
It was the choreography that was found offensive rather than the music. And the legend is that no one even heard the music. I don't believe that legend, but the music has never had a problem. You think of the first night, right? It's gone down in history as a scandal, sometimes even a riot. I'm sure that if we were able to go back to that night and revisit it, we'd be disappointed. It probably was just, you know, sort of a minor rustle, but gets built up over the century. You know, the Rite of Spring is many things, but it is not a herald of universal fellowship. And it is certainly not an ode to joy. You could hardly imagine devout or ceremonial performances of the Rite of Spring at occasions like the breaching of the Berlin Wall, when Leonard Bernstein so memorably led the Ninth Symphony. But neither could you imagine the Rite of Spring being ritually performed before an assemblage of the Nazi elite on Hitler's birthday, as you can behold Wilhelm Furtwängler on YouTube. Noble aspirations are transitive, they're relative. You know, the Nazis certainly thought of their cause as holy and noble, and this is, you see them celebrating it here. It casts a kind of counter shadow over the Ninth, does it not, to see this? And, you know, this is one of the things, I think, that has compromised the status of high art generally.
Do you remember the first time that you heard the Rite?
I do indeed. It was on a record by the Minneapolis Symphony, conducted by Anton Dorati. It was made in the 1950s, and I bought it for about a quarter. Second hand, or maybe tenth hand, it was an extremely scratchy record. So when I listen to it now, I miss the scratches. I was so excited by the piece the first time I heard it. You know, it's like trying to recapture the rush you got from your first cigarette. And you can't really recapture that, but it keeps you interested in the piece. And I'm just as interested now in hearing a new recording of the piece or a new performance of the piece as I was then. Rite of Spring would be for the 20th century what the Ninth Symphony was for the 19th century. The more you know about the context of a work of art, the more vivid the piece becomes to you, the more connections you can draw between it and the life of its time and the life of your own time. And so, yeah, I'm very much in favor of performers, knowing more. After all, I'm a scholar, and so, as far as I'm concerned, you can't be too well informed.
So I feel like this project, the lectures we have, and all the resources they show us is really helpful, because some resources are not really easy to find by ourselves, and we have a lot of classes, rehearsals every day. Actually, it's really hard to find time to really do a research.
We have amazing performers, we have scholars, we have dance historians, we have so many types of knowledge. It's wonderful to bring to bear all of these kinds of scholarship and performance together. To have an exposure to all of these kinds of things is a real remarkable thing.
To be able to be given that opportunity here at the Jacobs School of Music, for me, has allowed us to do an experiment on something that I've always believed is true, which is knowledge is power.